Well, this is a an investigation into an underloved and perhaps underappreciated group of great artists called stand-up comedians. And we wanted to go out and find out who these people really are. When we first started talking about making this film, people would say to us things like, they're all manic depressives. Well, they're not. They're a very diverse and fascinating group of truth talkers. And we've learned lots of wonderful life lessons, but essentially they are the great students of the human condition.
We decided quite early on that we needed to make this different, and so we didn't want to have pithy remark and then cut to a bit of stand-up, particularly as it would be archive stand-up and it would be fuzzy old shots of comedians standing in front of a brick wall. We decided we wanted to talk about them and what they do and to not see stand-up, and so then we decided to shoot them in black and white to remove and against a raw canvas backdrop with the same setup and the same camera position for all of them, apart from Jerry Lewis, who changed everything, but so that there was an equality. So whether you've got Kevin Hart or you've got a comedian who's just starting out, who's maybe 19, 20 years old, they can talk about the same things, they can discuss the same emotions and process of going through this what stand-ups have to do to get their art going, as with that 70-year gap. And so that's what the point of that was, so that you focused on their words and not just thought, when am I going to get to the joke?
One of the fascinating things, I don't know if this is a straight answer, but when you go out on the road, as we have done with some very successful stand-up comedians recently as part of our spin-off TV series we're making on the same subject, we were with Sebastian Maniscalco in Florida the other afternoon, and you're very struck by the fact that there's one man in a car with an arena full of people waiting to listen to him, and he doesn't have any musicians with him or any backing singers or any dancing girls, and he walks out on stage without any props and he starts talking. And this may be one of the reasons why people don't lavish this with the praise it deserves, because it looks easy. There's a recent poll conducted in America where the question was, what are you most scared of? And number one was talking in public, and number two was dying.
There are some amazing comedians that have definitely changed bits of the world and changed the way we think about race and gender and those kind of things, because they're the subjects, when they get onto that stuff, they can really make a point Richard Pryor, George Carlin, Louis C.K.'s, you know, those kind of people, Chris Rock's, those, you know, Eddie Murphy's,
Seinfeld,
Jerry Seinfeld.
Eddie Murphy, all amazing.
And, but, you know, from someone you've never heard of can make the most salient point about that moment, about the world, in a tiny stand-up club in front of 20 people, and for those 20 people, they will get something that will
never...
It may change their lives. Yeah, I'm going to say that.
I am so excited about seeing this film for the first time. I was aware, obviously, when it was in production quite a while ago, and all these huge comedic names that are attached, I can't wait to see what they're talking about. Well, I think stand-up is quite unique because in the main it's one person on stage trying to convince 100, 1,000, whatever many people into your way of thinking. So it's a bit like being a lawyer, I suppose, when you're in a courtroom and you're holding court and you want to convince a jury that your process, your thought process, is the correct thought process. And in one way that you can decide whether that actually works is whether the audience laugh or not. And it's the weirdest job in the world. It's very solitary, it's quite unnatural, but it also is the only job I can think of where you can stand up and say whatever it is you want. I absolutely believe in nothing is off limits. In the right hands, a great comedian can make a touchy subject that people obviously won't all agree on, can make it funny. It doesn't have to. We've moved on, thankfully, to an era where it's not just about sexist jokes, racist jokes, homophobic jokes. A lot more people are thinking outside the box, delving deep, and I think if you can, maybe timing is the only thing I'd add to that. Maybe timing, give something a bit of space to breathe. But if you've got a really good take on a subject, do it. Well, there are many factors that can contribute to an embarrassing stand-up experience. But I remember the very early days, one of my first gigs, I thought I'd nailed it. And I walked out into the audience and there was about probably 12 people in the room, and I played it like a huge rock star to next to nothing. And so when you walk off stage to the sound of your own heartbeat, that's when you know you've got to work at it. But the best, what can I say? Well, this job has allowed me to travel around the world doing jokes. And hopefully people continue to enjoy what I do and I'll keep carrying on. Well, it's festival season here in the UK, so I'm doing loads of festivals, including in the Edinburgh Festival, where I'm running out material to do a national tour, which starts in the UK in the autumn.
People need to laugh. We are living in a very, very uncertain age at the moment. We are confronted by unbelievable... I don't know how to describe it, really. I mean, politically, the country's split down the middle. We've got the threats of terrorism all around us. As the Chinese say, may you live in interesting times. That's a curse. Well, we live in very interesting times. And I think anyone with a sense of humour or any stand-up has to use his vocation at times like this to kind of settle people's nerves through the medium of stand-up and getting people to laugh. Because it's always there for us, even when times are really hard. I think if you feel you have a calling to make people laugh, now's the time, definitely. I have a lot of influences. Back when I was younger, I mean, obviously Tommy Cooper, you wouldn't really think of him as a stand-up, but he was a stand-up magician, comedian. He was a huge influence on me. Morecambe and Wise, they were a double act, but they were still, you know, still comics. They had a huge influence on me. But through the ages, I mean, I kind of like studied the comedy of history. So going way back, so like Max Miller, he was the guy that invented blue because he had a blue book and a white book. And they said, do you want the white book and a blue book? And they used to go blue because they were dirty jokes. So I've kind of, it's a studied thing, the history of comedy for me. So through the ages, I mean, if they make me laugh, I like them. There's so many, though, you know. I mean, recently, I saw Mickey Flanagan do 2 hours in Stockport, at a Cockney in Stockport, sold out. And it was sublime, absolutely sublime. I don't see a lot of gigs. It's a bit of a busman's holiday for me. But when I do, I'm pleasantly surprised how much I enjoy it. It's a bit like drawing cartoons of the Prophet Muhammad. You can court publicity, but then there's common sense and a moral obligation. So there's certain things I wouldn't go near. Do you know what I mean? I'm not a shock comic. I do believe stand-up is a genuine soapbox to air your views, no matter what your freedom of speech. But I think really, if you haven't got an angle on it and you haven't got the self-censorship to put it over in a way that's going to land, don't bother, really. I think there's things that you should just... I mean, I wouldn't want a fat one on my head, really. So I just stick to doing silly voices and jokes, really. There are those that lend themselves perfectly to that kind of... Like Lenny Bruce, you know, but Lenny Bruce, he's one of the, you know... That's what people... But the thing was, though, with Lenny... Early on, he was brilliant, but then when the law got involved, he became obsessed with the stand-up kind of went out of the window, and he got obsessed with the, you know, being censored. You know, I do believe in freedom of speech, but we all have a moral obligation. That's what I'm saying, basically. I am just about to. I've got 2.5 weeks left on Cold Feet. I've literally just come from set this morning. I've done a 5-hour scene. I know. A 5-hour scene this morning. I jumped on a train, got here, dumped my bag at the hotel, and I've come straight here with my daughter for the premiere. Well, I did ask for a day off, but they messed up the schedule. So that will be out in September. And the rest of the year is TBC. But I've just got a script today I've got to read on the way home. I've got to do the dreadful self-taping thing where, you know, you put yourself on tape, which is so hard. But, you know, don't knock it. Andy Lincoln got Walking Dead from that. So yeah, I've got a kind of a... The whole front end of this year has been Cold Feet. So I'll finish that, have a little break, and then we'll just have to... I'll put my hands in... Put myself in the hands of my very capable agent.
So the return of Cold Feet's been a storming success with critics and fans. Yeah. What can we expect overall from these new episodes that you guys have been working on?
This time, a bit of a slower burn, because we went in guns blazing last time. It's three very strong storylines. Jimmy's impulsive marriage, and then my suicidal depression. I mean, there's spoilers here if you've not seen it, sorry. And Robert's prison. So this time, it's a little bit more of a development of the relationship. It's, you know, the development of the relationships and everything that leads off that. But don't worry, there's still plenty of surprises. It's nice that people have said that when they were younger, oh, I used to watch this, give it a go. And a majority of their kids have embraced the show. Because there's so much variety, you know, on different platforms, Netflix, Amazon, all those. I mean, and the Americans have budgets like, you know, put us to shame. It's a joy that we've been able to, as a British series, deliver the goods and get, on the opening night this time around, 8.4 million viewers, which is unheard of these days. So it's so nice to be back and so nice to be in a success, because we left on a high when we first time round. Then to come back 13 years down, it would have been awful to have gone out like a damp squib, but we haven't. So I hope we deliver this time round. The last season or series, see what the Americans have done to me. The last series, it's quite. They said, what are you doing now? And I said, I'm doing Cold Feet. And they go, oh, there's another one. They thought it was a one-off reunion special. And we're pleasantly surprised to hear that it is coming back. So I'm sure if the people want it and the ratings are good, we'll keep coming back.